Good morning and welcome to my presentation. First of all, I would like to thank my mentor Nathan for inviting me to talk to you here today, and I hope that I'll be able to present you with something that you would find interesting to listen to. I would also from the outset like to invite your comments and suggestions. I have no handouts, but I have two draft papers, which I'd like to share with you if you are, after this talk, interested to know more. I'm basically a field linguist. I've described a small endangered Tibeto-Burman language spoken in the Eastern Himalayan region. I've written a grammar of that language, and then during my field research, I also collected data on seven related, presumably related, linguistic varieties. And right now I'm using these data to reconstruct the purported proto-language, which I've called Proto-Western Kobwa. And today I would like to share with you a few ideas on the onsets, looking from the perspective of two of these varieties. I'll start with a short introduction, because probably the Kobwa languages are, you are not very familiar with them, if you've ever heard of them at all. I will give a short introduction to my data and the methodology that I followed, which all of you are very much familiar with, so I'll not discuss that in detail. I'll quickly show a few trivial and regular correspondences, again, not very surprising, not very interesting, so I'll just go through them very quickly. And then I would like to focus on some of the more extraordinary, in not really maybe in a typological perspective, but at least in this case, what I found quite, what caught my attention, which are the palatalized onsets, the rhotic onset clusters, uvular onsets, voiceless onsets, and finally, I would like to show you a few noteworthy correspondences with other Tibeto-Burman languages. Kobwa languages are a small cluster of related supposedly related languages spoken in western Arunachal Pradesh, which is the area which is bordered by Bhutan in the west, Myanmar in the east, then the Tibetan Plateau and the Himalayas in the north, and the Brahmaputran plains of Assam in the south. Based on research materials that became available basically only in the last two decades of the previous century, it was Chanchin Jackson's son who first came up with the hypothesis that these languages, instead of being just some kind of a residue of languages, Tibeto-Burman languages actually might be related to each other. Since then, his view has been both adopted as well as challenged. However, till now there has not really been a lot of or any linguistic evidence which either supports or discredits his view. Among these Kobwa languages, a certain subgroup can be discerned, the Western Kobwa languages, which are mentioned here. Basically four languages with a total of eight individual varieties spoken by less than 7,000 people in the western part of Arunachal, with as closest genetic relatives Puroik and Bugun. All these languages must be considered endangered, not just because of the low speaker population, but also because of the rapid socio-economic developments in this area, which are really very rapid. This map shows all the hitherto identified Kobwa languages, the Puroik area, which is in the central and western part of the state, huge geographical area. They're speaking this language interspersed with Nishi, Bangru, and Miji speakers. Then here we find the closely related, mutually intelligible Bugun varieties. And here in the western part of the area, we find the western Kobwa languages, Kispi and Duhumbi spoken here. Then the Sahtang varieties spoken in this small area here, and the Sherdupen variety spoken in the Tenga River Valley. As you can see, this is a relatively fragmented area. There are speakers of other more dominant, both linguistically as well as socioculturally, more dominant speakers in the neighborhood, the Tongla speakers, for example, who separate the Kispi and Duhumbi from the other Western Kobwa speakers. So there has been a lot of language contact, both through contact languages as well as through inward migration and intermarriage, not just from Tongla, also from Central Bodish Brokpa, from the Tibetan side, Chöchangacha speakers from Bhutan, Khenkha speakers from Bhutan, and in the eastern part, the Miji and the Russo Akha. So a lot of contact language influence, which is important to be aware of. My former colleague Ismail Lieberheer and myself, we did a lexicostatistical study, a cognate count analysis with sensitivity analysis. And here you can see the results. We used 100 so-called stable roots, and around 20% of these stable roots are shared among all the Kobwa varieties. A percentage which goes up to around 40% between two individual Kobwa varieties. So that's not a lot, but in an area like this with so much of language contact, considering stable roots which are not very prone to borrowing, that might be indicative. We can also see that the Western Kobwa languages are the square in the left upper corner, Bugun languages in the middle, and the Puroik varieties, which show most internal variation, in the right lower corner. So there appears to be a rather clear subgrouping. My research is based on original field data of all the 8 known Western Kobwa varieties. I started out with a word list of more than 550 lexemes, which were from the most commonly used word lists, but also regionally, socioculturally, environmentally specific words which I collected based on my own experience in the area. A minimum of 2 speakers from each variety, and I also collected additional lexemes based on sentences, etc., to find more about the morphology of these varieties. Finally, I went back to elicit some missing lexemes, like the gaps in the cognate sets, and also some interesting forms on basis of particular onsets or particular rhymes, which I thought that might be interesting to have some more information about. Methodology you will all be very familiar with. One important thing to mention is perhaps that I started out with a comparison between Duhumbi and Khoitam, and the reason for that is that Duhumbi is rather conservative as far as rhymes are concerned. It has innovated a bit more in the onsets, and it's also been under more contact language influence, but still the rhyme patterns are very interesting. And Khoitam is rather representative of the Sartang and Sherdukpen varieties. Here are some trivial correspondences, nothing out of the ordinary here, in which all the Western Kobwa varieties have the same reflex from a reconstructed protoform. Regular correspondences where they don't all have the same reflex, but still these reflexes are not very surprising, not very special, and easily derivable from an onset. So rather than that, I would like to focus a bit more on some special onsets. First of all, there are a number of cognate sets where Duhumbi and Kispi have a voiceless palatal fricative onset, which corresponds regularly with aspirated palatal and alveolar affricates in the Sartang and Sherdukpen varieties. So my proposal here is that this derives from palatalized plosive onsets, both in the voiced and in the voiceless both the voiced and the voiceless counterpart there, in which it is the Sartang and Sherdukpen varieties which actually show a distinction between an aspirated reflex and a voiceless reflex. There's another correspondence set where a Duhumbi simple bilabial plosive onset corresponds to voiced palatal affricate onset in coitam. However, this is only when followed by a open high vowel, and this is actually a homophonous set of a homophonous correspondence for cognate sets in which we find this correspondence, which I've attributed to the open high vowel. And as you can see in the second set of examples, the influence of an open high vowel or open high vowel rhyme on an onset can be rather distinctive. So whereas normally we have a correspondence of a bilabial plosive in all varieties, there are a few cognate sets where we see a bilabial plosive in Duhumbi and Kispi correspond to the alveolar fricative, voiced alveolar fricative, the sibilant onset. So here we can see this distinct influence of high vowels and high vowel rhymes. You may notice that there is a kind of a noticeable correspondence between Western Kobois bilabial plosive onsets and nasal onsets in the Tibeto-Burman languages. This is something that I will come to a little bit later. Then the second is the rhotic onset clusters. There are certain correspondences where that are irregular in the sense that the correspondence itself is regular, the cognate sets are regular, but there is a different kind of reflex in some of the varieties. For example, here you can see that in the first group that the coitam reflex is an affricate, whereas we would have expected a simple velar onset. So in this case, I have reconstructed rhotic onset clusters, both with velar stops, with bilabial stops, and with a voiced alveolar fricative onset. So interesting is perhaps the phonological change that affected these onsets. These are regularly simplified in Duhumbi, Kispi, and the Cher du Pin varieties to a velar onset, but they became palatal affricates in Khoitam, Rahung, and Jirigaon, and they are very peculiar retroflex affricates, at least in a aerial perspective for the Western Kobwa languages. It's more common in Rushi's languages of the retroflex affricates. I have only one example from the voiced onset, and there are several examples from aspirated velar onsets. The reflexes are a little bit different in the case of a voiceless unaspirated velar onset. There is a glottal fricative onset in Jirigaon with a subsequent contraction of the root and the prefix. So in the first case of the wild boar, sehen becomes sin. In the second case, barking deer, sehi becomes si. But we see that the glottal fricative onset has been preserved in the case of bone, which might be attributed to the vocal prefix instead of the prefixes sha, the sha prefix, the meat or animal prefix. So this is the only case in which there are a little bit unexpected reflexes. We would have expected, for example, unaspirated, unvoiced reflexes also in Duhumbi, but as you can see in the case of barking deer, that correspondence holds, but in the case of wild boar and bone, there is aspiration, which may be attributed to a prefix. Clusters of a bilabial plosive and rhotic medial are simplified to bilabial plosive onsets in Kispi and Duhumbi, but have been preserved in the Sartang and Cher du Pin varieties, although the rhotic became a lateral medial in most Sartang and Cher du Pin varieties, except for Rahung, which has in most cases, well, in all cases, preserved the rhotic medial. The reason for not reconstructing bilabial plosive and lateral onset cluster here is because there is no other evidence for lateral onset clusters. So velar and lateral onset clusters, I have no evidence that suggests this, but as you saw on the previous slides, there is evidence for a velar and rhotic medial onset. And I've earlier shown that bilabial onsets followed by a high vowel or high vowel rhyme have divergent onset reflexes. The same is the case with these rhotic onset clusters. So the reflexes here are different from what we would expect. So again, it is this high vowel or high vowel rhyme which seems to have some kind of a mediating influence on the onset. These correspondences are the main source of the Dhoombi onset cluster psh, which indeed itself occurs only when followed by a high vowel or a high vowel rhyme. In the case of swell, fill, full, and for, the onset reflexes actually, in my opinion, may not really show for a onset cluster, but perhaps rather a prefix or a pre-initial rather than the onset cluster. But I'm sure there are people here who have their own interesting ideas on that, so maybe we keep that for discussion later. Now I would like to pay some attention to a rather motley mixed bag of correspondences that I was kind of left with after setting up all the other correspondence patterns. We see that the semantics of these sets are very clear. There is not much case of where you have to look for semantic cognate forms which are very different. And even the rhyme reflexes are rather predictable. They are regular. So the onsets are the only ones that are a little bit strange. And based on the comparative evidence, well, first after internal reconstruction, like after excluding other possible reasons, for example, other possible simple onsets, palatalized onsets, rhotic onset clusters, or possible explanatory phonotactic conditions, it is the comparative evidence where I found some information that this might actually derive from uvular onsets. In the Western Kogwa varieties themselves, uvular onsets are not attested except in Dhoombi, where it occurs as a allophone of a aspirated velar onset. For the rest, they are not a distinctive phoneme in any of the Western Kogwa varieties. So like I said, both the internal evidence in the form of onset correspondences that do not fit in with any of the other correspondences and comparative evidence from, in this case, quite often Old Chinese, or basically always Old Chinese, suggest that in these cases rhotic onset clusters of a uvular plosive can be reconstructed. And in this case, it's the unexpected rhyme reflexes in the case of soybean and egg, which actually necessitate a labialized onset. And in combination with the divergent onset reflexes, I propose that these derive from a labialized uvular stop, which in the case of koitam suk has actually been contracted. So there is again the prefix shahuak, which becomes seyuk in koitam and is then contracted to suk. For example, in jirigaon, we still find the original form seyuk. And in the case of hand arm, it is probably the complete absence of a prefix that resulted of the loss of the onset in the Sartan and Sher Dupin varieties, where they have now retained only a uvular vocal onset instead of the expected palatal glide. So it would have been yik if there had been a prefix, but because there was no prefix, the palatal glide was lost and it became ik. There are a few cognate sets where a Dhoombi and Kispi labial approximant onset corresponds to palatal approximant initials in Sartan and Sher Dupin. I propose that this derives from voiced uvular onsets, which again is kind of supported by the comparative evidence from Chinese, Old Chinese. There is another correspondence where vocal onsets in the Western Kobwa varieties correspond to voiced uvular onsets in Old Chinese, which I will show you in a few slides. There are several cognate sets between Western Kobwa varieties that cannot be explained. And here I would like to reconstruct voiceless onsets in which the characteristic reflex is actually a glottal fricative in at least one of the varieties. Why, in the case of voiceless nasal onsets, the glottal fricative is in the Humbi, whereas the nasal is in the Sartan and Sherdouk Ben varieties, but it's exactly the opposite when we look at the approximant onsets, in this case the palatal and the labial approximate onset. That is something that's still a bit of a mystery to me. Here are some of the examples. I think, considering the time, I will not go much into these. In the following slides, I'd like to present some additional evidence of relatively unique correspondences between Western Kobwa and other Tibeto-Burman languages. Some of these correspondences were already identified before, and I would like to present some additional evidence for these. Characteristic for the Kobwa languages is the correspondence between plosive onsets with nasal onsets in other Tibeto-Burman varieties. I saw already in your handouts that also is a correspondence between Basque and Proto, or considered to be a correspondence between Basque and Proto Indo-European, so it might not be that typologically that strange. But for the Tibeto-Burman languages, except for a few Bisu varieties, this is probably quite exceptional. Some examples of this correspondence are provided here, with the Western Kobwa reconstructions all having a plosive onset, but the comparative evidence from other Tibeto-Burman languages showing a nasal onset. This correspondence is also found in the velar point of articulation, as these examples show. Here a Western Kobwa velar plosive onset corresponds to other Tibeto-Burman velar nasal onsets. And there's even one case at the dental point of articulation, although the evidence is only for Duhumbi and Kispi, because the Sartan and Sherdouk Ben varieties have a nasal onset as the other Tibeto-Burman languages. I have noticed how somehow correspondences of Proto-Western Kobwa stop onsets often tend to correspond to Old Chinese nasal onsets in type A syllables. Some of these examples I already showed before. On the other hand, Proto-Western Kobwa nasal onsets often correspond to Old Chinese nasal onsets in type B syllables. So this is perhaps a kind of a noteworthy correspondence. However, as always, where you find regular correspondence patterns, you have your exceptions, where either Proto-Western Kobwa nasal onsets correspond to Old Chinese nasal onsets of in syllables of type A, where we can see that these syllables palatalize, the onsets palatalize in Western Kobwa, or we have Proto-Western Kobwa stop onsets that correspond to Old Chinese nasal onsets in syllables of type B. Now, because I'm still a little bit unfamiliar with the distinction between Chinese Old Chinese type A and type B syllables and the various theories that surround this, I cannot yet draw any conclusions regarding this. But these are just my observations, and I'm happy to hear people's ideas and suggestions. Another observation is that Western Kobwa vocal onsets often correspond to a sibilant onset in other Tibeto-Burman languages. Some of the cognate sets that show this correspondence are presented here. A major outstanding issue is shown in the last two examples, where a voiceless alveolar fricative onset in other Tibeto-Burman languages just regularly corresponds with a sibilant onset, or in some cases a glottal fricative onset in the Western Kobwa varieties. So what are the conditions that that result in debuccalization or in preservation of the original onset? This is again something that I will have to look into more closely. There's another set of correspondences where Western Kobwa vocal onsets correspond to reconstructed Old Chinese voiced uvular stop. In these cases, although it's tempting to reconstruct a voiced uvular stop for Proto-Western Kobwa, I think it is prudent to just reconstruct the most straightforward onset, which in these cases would be the vocal onset. Maybe later evidence will actually show that this derives from old uvular stop onsets. Then there is a regular correspondence in the Western Kobwa languages between voiceless dental nasal onsets, initials. Two examples of this are given here. In some cognate sets, we can observe how the voiceless dental onset in Western Kobwa corresponds to a voiceless lateral or voiceless or voiced lateral onset in type A syllables in Old Chinese. So again, just an observation of quite a regular pattern, at least in those cognate sets where I could find comparative evidence from Old Chinese. Although you may not really agree with all my semantic correspondences here. A rather curious correspondence that is nonetheless very regular is the correspondence between a Dohumbi and Kispi dental plosive onset and erotic onset in all other varieties. And I propose that this derives from an onset cluster of voiced alveolar fricative and erotic medial. As you already saw, erotic medial onset clusters are not uncommon, at least in the reconstruction. It's also noted how this Western Kobwa correspondent quite often tends to correspond with dental plosive onsets in Old Chinese. So again, a observation of a possible comparison with Old Chinese and other Tibeto-Burman languages. Okay. Wow.
Well, sorry, I didn't have to.
You didn't have to use the. Okay, thank you very much for your attention. If there are any questions, suggestions, ideas, then I would be happy to discuss them, since there is more than enough time anyway. So.